late semester forum. This is a terrific turnout, but not at all surprising given the topic and given the lineup of speakers here, including in particular our guest, Brad Smith, the Executive Vice President and General Counsel of Microsoft. He'll be introduced more formally in a moment, but I want to say myself how grateful we are, Brad, to you for being here today to anchor this terrific discussion about an awfully important set of issues: consumer privacy, human rights and privacy, whether from a surveillance perspective or otherwise, is an incredibly important set of issues, and we have, there could not be a better collection of people to discuss that set of issues with us and those we've assembled here today. So the panel will consider today the implications of government surveillance for companies in particular in the tech sector, and Brad Smith really is the ideal person to lead that conversation for us. And the issues also are ideally situated to be discussed here at NYU because they are the focus of our Information Law Institute, which I assume is familiar to many of you, but perhaps not all, and today is an opportunity to get to know a little bit more about it as well. It's been a thought leader in this area since its inception in 2000, under the stellar leadership of its director, Professor Helen Nissenbaum, who I will turn the microphone over to in a moment. The ILI brings together faculty, students, and researchers from across disciplines to promote research and commentary, and to in turn help shape law and policy relating to information technologies, data, and communication networks. And as for Helen Nissenbaum, there could be no better director of this initiative than her. She is professor of media, culture, and communications and computer science here at NYU. Her work spans social, ethical, and political dimensions of information technology and digital media. She is a prolific author, researcher, and commentator on these topics. She came to NYU after serving as associate director of the Center for Human Values at Princeton University. We are all grateful for her leadership in this area, and I'm happy to turn over the microphone to her.
Thank you very much, and welcome to everybody for this to this Milbank Tweed forum. Some of you may know that this is also a celebration of a very generous gift from Microsoft to the Information Law Institute that will fund many of our activities. Thank you to Dean Morrison for this introduction, for being here. I know you have to rush off to do your other dean duties, but I do want to say that the law school has provided ongoing and tremendous support for the Information Law Institute, and this has been crucial to our ongoing success both within NYU and on the national stage. And at this point, I also want to thank Professors Catherine Strandberg and Ira Rubinstein, who are part of the leadership team and also will be participating and leading our discussion today. As you've heard, the Information Law Institute is an academic, and I'll say a few words about the Information Law Institute and then introduce our speaker, Brad Smith. The Information Law Institute is an academic center devoted to the study of critical societal issues relating to digital technologies and information. The programs that we support include a fellowship program, and this year, for example, we're supporting 6 outstanding research fellows and postdocs in law, social science, and computer science. We have ongoing research seminars on security and privacy, and we have held many conferences, symposia, and workshops. Now, we've enjoyed the participation from law school faculty and always are delighted to welcome students in our activities. And if any of you sitting here are interested in participating in Information Law Institute events, please let me or Professors Rubinstein and Strandberg know, and we would love to include you. The conferences that we've held, and many of these have been supported by Microsoft along the way,
have included such topics as privacy and health information technology, mobile and location privacy, online hate speech and cyber harassment, and national and international privacy legislation, among many other topics. With this gift that we're celebrating today, we have an assurance that our Fellows Program has ongoing support for the next 4 years. And for that, we've been very excited to be able to look ahead and know that our Fellows Program is underwritten, and also deeply grateful for that. Our fellows, supported by Microsoft, have made significant contributions to issues relating to big data and economic inequality, information asymmetry and the weakening of consumer and labor power, regulation of information intermediaries for competition and accountability, mobile and location privacy, the impact on student privacy of cloud-based, data-driven, and profit motivated educational services, and the impacts of IT on Fourth Amendment practice and interpretation. It gives me great pleasure to introduce Brad Smith. The gift awarded by Microsoft not only provides material support, but constitutes an expression of confidence in what the Information Law Institute has done and what more it promises to do going forward. Brad Smith is Microsoft's General Counsel and Executive Vice President of Legal and Corporate Affairs. With approximately 1,100 employees located in 55 countries, and it's responsible for the company's legal work, intellectual property portfolio, and patent licensing business, as well as government affairs, public policy, and corporate citizenship and philanthropy. He also serves as Microsoft's corporate secretary and its chief compliance officer. Brad Smith has overseen numerous negotiations leading to competition law and intellectual property agreements with governments around the world and with companies across the IT sector. He's played a leading role within Microsoft and in the IT sector on intellectual property, privacy, immigration, and computer science education policy issues. As the senior executive responsible for ensuring Microsoft fulfills its corporate responsibilities, he's helped the company achieve its consistent ranking in the top 2% of the S&P 500 for corporate governance scores. He's played a leadership role locally in the state of Washington and nationally in charitable, diversity, business, and legal initiatives. Brad Smith graduated summa cum laude from Princeton University. He earned his JD from the Columbia University School of Law and studied international law and economics at the Graduate Institute of International Studies in Geneva. He's written numerous articles and commentaries on international intellectual property and internet issues, immigration and education policy, and has served as a lecturer at the Hague Academy of International Law. Recently, Smith was named by the National Law Journal as one of the 100 most influential lawyers in the United States. Colleagues, please join me in welcoming Brad Smith to NYU.
Well, thank you. It's great to be here, and it's a wonderful pleasure to join these four individuals on this panel for what I think is an incredibly interesting and important set of issues that I think all of you will have the opportunity not only to learn about and think about as students, but undoubtedly contribute to and influence over the course of your careers. I thought what I would do to start this off was take about 20 minutes to frame the issues, and that hopefully will help contribute to a good and lively discussion among all of us and with all of you. Let me just start as we think about the future of privacy, and pause to reflect upon the past year. I think that the past year is reflected well in this photograph. It has been an unusual and even amazing year when one thinks about the issues that have arisen, really starting last June, when Edward Snowden took four laptops and went to Hong Kong and then on to Russia. that brought to the surface a number of new questions, and I think it has really set in motion a broad discussion that starts with government surveillance, but I think ultimately includes questions that people naturally may have about how companies use personal data as well. Now, a lot of this first came out of a series of stories that was published initially in the Guardian newspaper. And as many of you know, the Guardian started by publishing basically a story about each document that it would decide to write about. One of the stories that caught our attention when we were reading them at Microsoft was this one that appeared last summer. It described a report that the NSA had had a voluntary program outside of legal subpoena and legal process with certain companies to obtain on a bulk basis massive records of telephone records or email or other records. And interestingly, this document had as part of it a report by the Inspector General, the IG of the NSA. And the Inspector General described a number of companies. The companies weren't named in the document. They were companies A through H. And it described in a paragraph the NSA's interaction with each company. And when one read this, companies A and B sounded like telephone companies. They sounded like they had provided a great deal of information on a voluntary basis. And as we read it, there was one company that especially attracted our attention at Microsoft. It was the reference to Company F. And the description said that on the 29th of October in 2002, NSA legal and operational personnel met with internet provider Company F's legal and corporate affairs personnel. I can tell you, because it certainly wasn't classified, that in 2002 at Microsoft, our department was called then, as it is called now, the Department of Legal and Corporate Affairs. I can also tell you, because there's no way one could possibly classify it, that to the best of my knowledge, at least at that time, there was no other department in the industry that had that same name. I can't tell you anything more than that. But I can tell you a little bit about what this paragraph said. It said that the NSA requested Company F's support for email content. What the IG report basically says is they were out asking for the ability to get bulk on a bulk basis, lots of content from tech companies. And the paragraph goes on to explain that Company F did not participate because of corporate liability concerns. It just so happens that the two lawyers who were most involved in these issues in 2002 are both sitting here today. Ira was actually the one who was far and away the most involved. He was and he would work with me when that was needed. I had become the general counsel of the company on July the 1st, 2002, just a few months before this happened. And what I can tell you is a couple of things that I think when you step back are sort of obvious. The first is no one in 2002 could have predicted that an individual named Edward Snowden would emerge and take laptops and fly around the world and release all of these documents. But I will also tell you that at the time, as people like Ira and I thought about and talked about these issues in the wake of 9/11, there was something that actually was quite predictable, because one could just look back at the history of this country. Before 9/11, there were three times in the history of the United States when, in a time of national crisis, the rule of law and civil liberties shifted in order to protect national security. The first was during the Napoleonic War. John Adams was president, and the Congress passed what were called the Alien and Sedition Acts, which basically restricted free speech, in part out of concern that the public debate was going to drag the United States into the war between Britain or France on one side or the other. The second was during the Civil War, when President Lincoln suspended the writ of habeas corpus, and people were jailed without any right to a trial. And the third was in World War II, when Franklin Roosevelt interned many Japanese Americans simply because they were Japanese American. And each time the country accepted those changes in the moments of national crisis, but each time the pendulum swung back. And I think the clear lesson today is a lesson that we were able to think about and talk about over a decade ago. While these decisions are initially made amidst a sense of crisis, the pendulum always swings back. And when the pendulum swings back, people step back and they start to ask themselves, where are they comfortable striking the balance between the protection of national security and the protection of people's civil liberties? And ultimately, over time, people are more often judged not by the mood of the moment, but by the broader perspective that emerges after that moment passes. We thought about that when we made our own decisions as a company. And in that context, while no one could predict an individual named Edward Snowden would enter the scene, I actually believe that the debate that is taking place now is not only a healthy one, it was and is an inevitable one. Inevitably, this moment would come and this debate would be needed. As we first reacted to this last summer, the first thing we did when we read these stories in The Guardian describing this program that the NSA had called PRISM is that we had never heard of it. The only thing we knew about were the legal orders that had been served upon us. And so the first thing that we did, at Microsoft and Google did really within a week of each other, is we sued the federal government. We sued them claiming that we had a right under the First Amendment, in fact, to publish more information about the orders that were being served on us and the information that we were turning over to the government in response. There were settlement negotiations last summer. I led them on the Microsoft side. Ultimately, those negotiations collapsed in August when we failed to reach an agreement with the Department of Justice, which was negotiating on behalf, really, of both the FBI and the NSA. There was one thing that none of us in the tech sector knew when this was unfolding last summer. And it's something that came to the surface when the Washington Post ran a story at the end of October. And in a sense, it was the missing piece in the puzzle, at least for those of us who had followed it. The Washington Post reported that the NSA had apparently tapped into either the undersea cables or, in some other matter, the data centers themselves of Google and Yahoo without those companies knowing about it. And it's still not entirely clear from this or other reports whether this is or was the NSA operating by itself or whether it was the NSA operating with the collaboration of another government, perhaps the British government, for example. But basically, for those of us in the tech sector, we knew what we knew. We knew what we had turned over. We felt that what we had turned over was, in fact, rather limited. And yet we were reading these stories that kept suggesting that the NSA had a lot more information than we believed. This, for the tech sector, really, frankly, sort of set the industry's hair on fire because we thought we were working pursuant to legal process alone, and suddenly we concluded that a lot more was going on than we had first realized. I do think that the US government started to put itself on a different path when President Obama got involved. I had the pleasure to have an opportunity to have some conversations with him, participated in the tech sector's meeting with him in December, and he gave a speech on the 17th of January. And in the speech, I think he framed it well. He said we have to make some important decisions about how to protect ourselves and sustain our leadership in the world while upholding the civil liberties and privacy protections our ideals and our Constitution require. And the speech itself was relatively limited. You know, he took some steps. Most people, at least in the tech sector, said these are good steps, but they don't seem to go far enough. It's interesting, he gave this speech on the morning of January 17th. The evening before, on January 16th, we got a call from the Department of Justice saying, now we're prepared to settle that lawsuit that you filed. And in fact, that unleashed about 5 weeks of pretty frenetic negotiation between a number of companies in the tech sector with the Justice Department. Ultimately, I think the question that all of this raises front and center is fundamentally the role of the Fourth Amendment of the Constitution in the 21st century. You know, it's actually not an amendment that has received as much public discussion over the last two decades. You hear more about the Second Amendment and gun control, or the First Amendment and freedom of expression. But the Fourth Amendment, I think, has reemerged in importance. And what it says is that it guarantees the right of the people to be secure in their persons, houses, papers, and effects from unreasonable search and seizure. It is, in reality, one of the fundamental values that has been recognized in this country since the Bill of Rights was adopted. And in fact, it came to the United States from English common law in the 1760s, where it was a lively issue that our founders were very determined to ensure was preserved when the Constitution was adopted. And I think, in brief, there's a few questions that it raises. The first is, will we continue in the future, as we have had in the past under the Fourth Amendment, to live in a society where the government obtains information pursuant to probable cause? What the Fourth Amendment says is that warrants will issue only upon probable cause. In other words, when the government has some specific reason to suspect that some specific individual is doing something, it will have the ability, typically, to go to a court to obtain the right to go access that information. But then, and only then, that is one of the questions that is now put before us as we talk about the role of the Fourth Amendment going forward. It closely connects to the entire practice of bulk collection of information. Because in effect, in a world of big data, which people started to recognize as early as 2002 was actually upon us, people realized that there was an alternative. The government could get all of the metadata about telephone records. It could get all of the email content. It could put it all in a database. It could even call the database Prism if it wanted. And then when it had a concern about an individual, it could run a search, and it could do so immediately. That, I think, is at fundamental odds with the principle of probable cause. And while President Obama, in his speech in January, stated that he thought the question needed to be asked about whether bulk collection should continue, we've seen in the ensuing months further steps by the administration to pull back from bulk collection, which I think in a way is an affirmation of the fundamental principles in the Fourth Amendment. As this has been happening, we've seen a renewed focus on transparency. And as I mentioned, we entered into negotiations to settle the lawsuit. The lawsuit was, in fact, settled, and on a single day, Microsoft, Facebook, Google, and Yahoo all published our surveillance data. And we did so under the terms of the settlement. We were able to therefore say that, you know, in the first 6 months of 2013, we had received fewer than 1,000 FISA orders, and they had sought content from customer accounts that numbered between 15,000 and 15,999. And we'll be able to publish similar information in six-month increments as we go forward. I think more broadly than this, there is a very important question that, in my own opinion, has not yet received sufficient attention, and this is a great place for people to start to think about it. How do we ensure that there is effective judicial review of government surveillance actions? You know, today, over the last decade, this has all gone to a specialized court, the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act, or FISA Court. It is an unusual court in many ways. It has 15 judges, all of whom are appointed by one person who's not the President of the United States, but instead the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. Now, they're all federal judges, so they were all appointed and confirmed at one time. But they don't reflect the diversity that one would typically expect to find among district courts across the country. And indeed, the Senate plays no role in confirming them. The court actually meets in secret. It doesn't just take documents under seal the way most courts do. The entire court works in secret. If you want to write a law review article on the opinions it issues, you will have a very difficult time because the opinions remain in secret. There's no adversarial system the way there typically is in the United States. And while people, including the president, have recommended that there be an advocate, it will not be an advocate who actually has a client and access to facts the way one typically does. And even when one occasionally finds oneself as a litigant before this court, it's far different from litigation in many other places. We found that when we sued the government and the case went before the FISA court. We filed our papers, the government filed its papers. It was our job then to file a reply to the government's papers. Try drafting a reply to this. Personally, I think that there are fundamental questions of due process under the Fifth Amendment when one must reply to a government brief that has been heavily redacted. The judge is permitted to know what the government is arguing, but not the lawyer or the parties on the other side. Even though the party on the other side has lawyers who have national security clearance at a very high level and are required to do so so they can interpret and apply and obey the court orders that this specific court issues. But they're still not permitted, at least according to the government in this case, to actually read everything that the government is writing. All of this, of course, takes place against a backdrop of the world. When the Snowden disclosures first took place, the White House was quick to say that Americans need not worry, this was only being done to foreigners. The reality is that 96% of the people in the world are not American. And so 100% of the stakeholders for the United States government may be American. But actually, if you're a technology company, there's not quite the overlap that the politicians enjoy. So we've been forced as an industry to think about the world. And increasingly, I think the White House and the president himself, I think quite rightly, has focused more on the world. One of the things that prompted us to do was take steps in December to tell the world that we would protect its data, including from surveillance by multiple governments around the world. We would expand and strengthen encryption. We would increase the transparency of our code so that other governments could inspect it in a secure facility and satisfy themselves that there were no back doors. We would reinforce legal protections in our contracts, which actually have come to play quite an important role. We also decided in January that we would allow, for example, enterprise customers in Europe to store their content data in Europe and not have it inside the territory of the United States, because then, in certain scenarios, it would not be subject to U.S. legal jurisdiction, something that has proven to be quite important to governments, for example, that happen to be based in Europe. And ultimately, we've recognized that a lot of these issues are going to require some new forms of international law as well. I don't see how we get through the next decade without some new forms of international agreements, at least among like-minded governments. Now, all of that is important, and it helps frame the issues around surveillance. The other point I would touch upon is how to think about this issue more broadly. The surveillance issue, I believe, is fundamentally about the relationship between governments and citizens and when the government can access data and what it can do with it. Now, at the same time, there's an issue around company use of data from consumers. Interestingly, I think in part attributable to the different constitutional foundations of the United States and the European Union, there's more law in the United States about the role of government, and there's more law in Europe about access to data by companies. Of course, there's a common name that applies to both citizens and consumers. It's called people. And for all of us, we're people. And this is fundamentally about our relationship with both governments and companies. When you think about that, I think one of the things that's really interesting is to think about this phrase and what was, frankly, I think one of the more influential articles ever written in a law review is by Louis Brandeis when he was a professor in 1890. And this was, as you may know, sort of one of the seminal, if not the seminal, piece on the right to privacy, which he called the right to be let alone. One of the things that's really interesting about this article is that phrase, the right to be let alone, is used at the end of a paragraph. The beginning of the paragraph talks about recent inventions and business methods. In effect, the right to privacy came out of a discussion that was spurred by new technology. It was the camera. and people suddenly found that they were being photographed as they stepped out onto the sidewalk, and perhaps they really didn't want to be photographed next to the person they happened to be standing with. And people started to talk about having a right to privacy. Well, interestingly, 124 years later, here we are again talking a lot about the right to privacy. And one of the things that people often ask is, do people care about privacy any longer? Do young people care about privacy any longer? One of the things that I often hear people ask is, well, consider Facebook. Look at Facebook. Facebook is exhibit A to the argument that people no longer care about privacy. Well, I actually think it's interesting to think about Facebook and look what happened. It just so happens that on April the 4th, 2007, Microsoft bought a minority share in Facebook. On that day, Facebook had 25 million users. MySpace had 104 million. Mostly in the tech sector, if one company gets to 100 million users first, and if it's more than four times its next closest competitor, that company that gets to 100 million first is going to win. But look what happened to MySpace, and look what happened to Facebook. And you can ask, why did that happen? That is actually so unusual. Well, part of the answer is captured in this book, The Facebook Effect, where, as David Kirkpatrick, a writer, points out that on MySpace, by default, you shared everything you posted with the world. You had to go in and reset your settings in order to only share it with a subset of the world. Whereas on Facebook, as everybody knows, by default, you only share things with your friends or in a network of students or employees, and then you have to go in and change the settings if you want to share it with the world. Well, it turned out that people were much more comfortable sharing with their friends than sharing with the world. And as Kirkpatrick observed, actually that was part of what enabled Facebook to overtake MySpace. Well, if people don't care about privacy, why would that have had any impact at all? I think the real answer is that the definition of privacy has changed. I think today people want to share more personal information. But there's a really big but. The but is that they actually want to decide who they share that information with. And they want to control or determine how that information is used once they share it. The fact that they share it does not mean that they want to lose all control of it. And if there's another really interesting case that I think illustrates this, it's Snapchat. The CEO of Snapchat, I will venture, is quite possibly younger than most people in the room. He's only 23. He could have spent his first year after college at NYU Law School. Instead, he created this company, and he's been offered $3 billion by one company and $4 billion by another to sell his company. So what is this company all about? Well, the CEO, Evan Spiegel, gave a keynote in Los Angeles a few months ago, and he said his company was fundamentally about three things that together added up, in his opinion, to what he called more personal computing. It was about the ability to use technology to access and create media on the fly, connect to the internet in a wireless way. But he added this third concept, which he called ephemerality. And what he said was this: this brings us to the importance of ephemerality at the core of conversation. Snapchat, as you all, I'm sure, know, discards content. It's only around for 10 seconds after you look at the photo. To focus on the feeling that content brings to you, not the way that content looks. This is a conservative idea, the natural response to radical transparency that restores integrity and context to conversation. Snapchat sets expectations around conversation that mirror the expectations we have when we're talking in person. When email was first invented, this would be something that would be more memorable to probably us than to many of you. One of the things lawyers first talked about was that one of the deficiencies of email is you lost all this context. If you were having a conversation at the proverbial water cooler, people had all the context. Well, in email, all the context was lost. What he is saying is that this brings back the context. You have the mood of the moment, and equally, you don't have that item after the mood of the moment passes. And what's so interesting is Evan Spiegel says this is a conservative idea, the natural response to radical transparency. You know what's interesting about this? He never uses the word privacy. But I think to many people, this is a privacy manifesto from someone who is 23 and created a $4 billion company. Ultimately, this, I think, has implications that are profound across the board and certainly for legal questions. If you look at the Supreme Court and you look at the evolution of jurisprudence around the Fourth Amendment, it's always about when people have what's called a reasonable expectation of privacy. And in a case 2 years ago called U.S. v. Jones, there's a very short concurring opinion by Soto Sotomayor. I think this concurring opinion may become the Brandeis article and reference to the right to be let alone of our time. Because in this two or three pages, Justice Sotomayor basically poses this question. Has the definition of privacy changed? It used to always mean keeping something secret. For not just decades, but centuries, when people said, I want to keep something private, they probably meant they were wanting to keep it secret. But do we now think about it as I want to share but control how people use the information I give them? And if so, is secrecy still a prerequisite for having a reasonable expectation of privacy? This is now a major constitutional question. And similarly, I would say, if you look around the world, we're seeing, if privacy doesn't matter, a lot of governments do things that are pretty inexplicable, especially if they are governing democratic societies. They're writing and adopting more and more privacy laws. And even in the United States, we're just seeing a growing tidal wave of legislation. Last year in California alone, there were 33 privacy bills introduced. To sort of bring this all together, I'd say as we look to the future, we're going to live in a future with ubiquitous computing. Think about this. In the world today, there are 1 billion personal computers, there are 2 billion smartphones, there are 7 billion people, and in the next 5 or 6 years, there will be 50 billion devices connected to the internet. Every thermostat, smoke detector, fire extinguisher, parking meter, parking light, garbage can, it'll all be connected, it'll all be intelligent. It is just natural that people are going to have questions about what all of this means. I think that it was summed up in this article recently that a Google engineering director said the company will know you better than your spouse does. I don't think that's what most people aspire to. You know, I just wish there was a company that knew me better than my wife. You know, it's not really a value proposition in and of itself. But there is a lot of value that can come if tech companies use this knowledge well. But all of this poses questions. And ultimately, if we go back to this framework, we're really talking about government and companies on the one hand and citizens and consumers on the other. I do think that there's four questions one can think about. The first is, what transparency will there be? To what extent will the public and consumers have knowledge about who has their data and how that data are being used? That's all about transparency. Second, who's going to control when people are able to access data and what they're going to do with it? When it comes to the government, one typically looks to the rule of law, laws passed by a democratically elected legislature to define what governments do. When it comes to company use, it's usually a contract. It's a contract that today is grounded on notice and consent. I think it is a framework in the future that may also involve, to an increasing degree, new tools and new legal frameworks that, in effect, manage how companies use the data that they have on people. Third, what accountability will there be? I believe that the government can only be accountable if there is accountability to the courts through effective judicial review. Hence, I believe there's a need for more discussion about the FISA court. And in the same way, I think if you want to have accountability by companies, you're really talking about what role will regulation play and how will that be grounded in the law. And finally, we need to recognize that all of this is something that's not just a national or local issue, it's global. How will governments
interact and collaborate together in the context of new international treaties. Yeah, to conclude, I would say this. If you think about the moment in time in which all of you who are students today are living, there are two fundamental factors, among others, but two fundamental factors that are shaping this world today. One is the fact that the threats to security and the war on terrorism has, in effect, become a permanent war. Unlike the Napoleonic War, or the Civil War, or World War II, we live in a time when people have accepted the notion that there is a permanent war, and it requires that there therefore be some permanent steps taken to protect the public and national security. At the same time, we live in a world today where there is unprecedented amounts of information, not only about us, but in a form that is easy to provide or share with or be accessed by others. More data than ever existed for any generation in the history of the planet. If you think about the future and the issues that I think your generation will need to play an incredibly influential role in shaping, it is this tension between the protection of people's safety and security in what feels like an increasingly unsafe world and the management of people's personal information in this new era of digital data everywhere. It is a question that lawyers will need to play a profound role in helping society answer. And I believe it is a question that will literally require at least the next couple of decades to unfold and decide. And hence, I think that this is a great time to be in law school. So thank you very much.
So thank you very much, Brad. I'm Professor Kathy Strandberg here at the law school. I teach information privacy law, as many of you know. I see a lot of familiar faces out there, and also intellectual property law. So first of all, thank you very much, Brad, for your remarks, which I think will help us kick off a really great discussion. So I'm going to start by introducing the terrific people we have up here on the panel. And then I'm going to throw out some questions for discussion among those of us up here. We'll do that for a while, and then we'll give an opportunity for you to ask your questions. So let me begin by introducing Florencia Marotta-Wurgler, who's over there on my left. She is a professor at New York University School of Law. She's also a faculty fellow of the Information Law Institute. And her teaching and research interests are in the area of contracts, electronic commerce, privacy online, law and economics, and commercial law. Currently, her research is focusing on standard form contracting online. In particular, she's performed extensive empirical work in this area and currently is engaged in an extensive and detailed study of online privacy policies, their compliance with fair information practices and various other guidelines, and the way in which they change over time. She's testified about her research to the United States Congress. And finally, she is an alumna of NYU Law School. Next, over here on my right, is Professor Michael Posner, who is relatively new to NYU. He's a professor of business and society at NYU's Stern School of Business. And he's the founder of a really exciting initiative over there, the Center on Business and Human Rights, which is the first such center to be established at a business school. From 2009 to 2013, he served in the Obama administration as Assistant Secretary of State for the Bureau of Democracy, Human Rights, and Labor at the State Department. Before that, for many, many, many years, from 1978 to 2009, he led Human Rights First, a New York-based human rights advocacy organization that I'm sure many of you are familiar with. And throughout his career, he has been a prominent voice in support of human rights protections in many areas, in global business operations, including the information and communications technology sector. He was also a founding member of the Global Network Initiative, which is a multi-stakeholder initiative aimed at promoting free expression and privacy rights on the internet, and has spoken in many, many places on these issues. He received his JD from UC Berkeley. And then finally, directly on my left here is Professor Ira Rubinstein, who is a senior fellow at the Information Law Institute here at NYU and adjunct professor of law. In 2010, he also joined the board of directors of the Center for Democracy and Technology. And he has written on many aspects of issues relating to big data, including a research report on systematic government access to personal data prepared for CDT, other works on privacy and big data, and in particular on privacy by design, and recent work on voter privacy. Before coming to join us here at the ILI, he spent 17 years, as already has been referred to, in Microsoft's legal and corporate affairs department, most recently as associate general counsel in charge of the regulatory affairs and public policy group. And Ira is a graduate of Yale Law School. So that's the fabulous panel. So now let me start us off by a question, and I'll just sort of get people's responses, and we'll go from there. So as was pretty evident from Brad's remarks, one of the big issues in privacy today is that everything we're doing in everyday life is mediated by these technologies that create and record information about us. And in fact, most of us have little control over our understanding of what's going on with this information, who has it, what they can do with it. And then sort of at the other side of this, we have an increasing trend toward employing so-called big data or data mining approaches to trying to understand and solve social problems. So I think that one way to put the question that we're going to answer or try to discuss here is, how do these developments change the way that we should approach privacy protection? And I want to start us off by focusing on the paradigm of consent, which Brad did mention, notice and consent, in his remarks. The paradigm of consent has, based on privacy policies, has been the dominant regulatory theme in commercial use of personal data in the United States. And in fact, because of the so-called third-party doctrine, which at least is interpreted by some people, removes Fourth Amendment protection and some courts from personal data that is held by companies, government access to personal information also increasingly is determined by consent based on privacy policy. So the question I want to pose to the panel is consent still a meaningful framework for privacy regulation in either the government or commercial side? And are there ways we can make it work if it's not working, or is it just fundamentally flawed and we need to replace it with something else? So those are the questions. And anybody want to take a beginning crack at that? Florencia, you look like you're eager to
speak.
Okay, I
can talk about consent in the commercial setting. So notice and consent has been the main way to give individuals control, or at least some sense of information about what happens to the to their personal information. But consent, as Kathy mentioned, is perhaps one of the most problematic aspects of the relationship between individuals and companies when it comes to setting the terms of the collection of this information. So right now, for most companies, this relationship is established and maintained through privacy policies. And all that is required right now is for the company to give to provide reasonable notice and an opportunity to read and then the contract, if there are other safeguards are ensured so it's not unconscionable, the contract will be enforced. So readership is not required. There's an opportunity to read. The problem with this, and it happens in most standard form contract environments, but specifically in privacy, for what I'll mention in a second, is that most people don't read or pay attention. And if they do, it is hard for them to understand the terms of the contract. And let me talk a little bit about what these contracts look like right now. So right now, at least in the sample of 200 or so contracts that I've studied in social networks and message boards and dating sites, they're an average of about 2,000 words long. They get longer over time. You know, for the past 5 years, have increased an average of 30%. They tend to change rather frequently, some of them up to 50 times a year, just one of them up to 50 times a year, but rather frequently. And terms tend to be open-ended. So for example, we might share information with third parties without explaining when that might happen or who those third parties are. And so it's hard to extract meaning from them, not only for the individual consumer who might not even bother reading it, but also for these informed intermediaries that are supposed to save the day and inform us in a more digestible manner what these contracts say. And there's many of these endeavors that they just haven't really taken off, and I think the complexity of these contracts might be to blame. And also, oftentimes, about 50% of the times, they're internally contradictory. So they will say that they won't, I'm not saying all of them, I'm talking on average. The contract might give you the right, they promise not to share your information, but then they will allow for third parties to actually extract that information from their site. So it's hard to make meaning of them. And so I'm wondering, given the nature of these contracts and given consumers' attitudes towards contracts, whether notice and consent is really the way to go, at least when it comes to contracts. Are we asking these documents to do too much? It's hard for individuals to control information when they don't know, or for example, when companies give you the choice but they don't tell you how. So right now, I get the sense from what I read that privacy policies, even if there's reasonable notice, and even if they're reasonably accessible, and even if they're readable, right now they don't provide individuals with enough tools for them to exercise their control. It's hard for them to become informed, and it's hard for them to exercise control over their information. So for me, in my view right now, the way in which contracts are being presented to consumers is asking too much of them. And I wonder, given the dynamic nature of the industry, and I understand that there's a need to continuously update these contracts because the relationship between what the product is or the service is and the consumer is continuously changing, whether there can be a set of minimum standards or we can manage some sorts of expectations about how information is going to be used that can be maintained over time, or is this just a myth? So that's what I'm, those are my thoughts on notice and consent.
I'm going to come at this from a different perspective. Florencia has really talked about the relationship between companies and consumers. I want to look at the other side, which is the government side. And here I think the concept of consent really, I wouldn't say it's meaningless, but it certainly has to be looked at very differently. I want to come back to something that Brad said. And I think it's important that we frame this discussion very broadly in looking at the world post 9/11. Brad said at the end, and it's something that is often said, we have a permanent war. I reject that. I think that's not the right way to look at this. There are a range of new threats in the world, but I think we've gotten ourselves in a box when we use the nomenclature of war to describe a range of activities that the government has to undertake. Interrogation, detention, laws of war do fit in that, drones and the like. But I think the question of information gathering, surveillance, intelligence is also part of what I would call a new normal. But I don't think we should call it a war. What we need to be thinking about is what are the both obligations of government to keep us safe, and on the other side, what are the constraints on government to prevent misapplication of that government authority. And we're seeing that converging with a set of new technologies. Certainly in this area, the government has the capacity to collect a lot of information in ways that 10 years ago, certainly 50 years ago, but even 5 years ago, we wouldn't have thought possible. So I think it's very important that we come back in this country to a notion that the new normal may have some different aspects, but it is still it's regulated by a set of laws and principles which have been with us for 200 years plus. And so that is the Fourth Amendment analysis. Mm-hmm. It really is important for us not to say, we've been attacked. It's now incumbent on those who provide national security to do whatever it takes. This is what we need to walk back from in the post 9/11 notion of law-free zones. Of a notion that somehow we're in a new reality, a global war, which removes legal and political constraints. So that's a little bit of a different take than on consent, but I do think it's an important frame for us in the United States to be thinking about these issues. How do we get back to a place where we understand the importance of information gathering and intelligence, which, by the way, is very different than law enforcement? Mm-hmm. How do we take that discussion seriously, but not start from the premise, which is, I think, the way a lot of people in the intelligence agencies view this, as my job is to keep America 100% safe. You cannot do that without looking for every bit of data on Earth and using it in whatever ways you determine to be that which is needed to keep America 100% safe. Let's put that on the table and say, all right, how do we keep our country safe and at the same time preserve the values and legal principles that have made this country great?
Building on what Florencia said, I would suggest that there are really two fundamental flaws with the choice model. One is, as she pointed out, that there's a lack of awareness and understanding as to what notices say or what the choices actually are. But I think the second is that choice, even if achieved, is not necessarily the same as privacy. One reason for that is that choice is often not voluntary. You see this particularly on the government or law enforcement side, where doctrines like the third-party doctrine result in a fairly arbitrary notion of what choice amounts to. If I use a cell phone, what choice do I have about whether a cell tower knows my location? If I use other services that require certain information to be shared, to call that a choice and then to arbitrarily say, well, you've made this choice, so now you have no protection under the Fourth Amendment, just seems like a mistake. So on the government side, I think there's a need for rethinking the third-party doctrine, and in that same opinion that Brad referred to, Justice Sotomayor suggested that it was time to do so. On the commercial side, I think the problem has more to do with the overemphasis on choice in lieu of other principles of fair information practices. And Brad mentioned one of them, which is accountability, but I think the other really significant one is data minimization. So even if choices are made, the average consumer is completely clueless, really, as to how data will be used in the future, what data it will be combined with, what new uses it will be put to, what the consequences of sharing that data are. So even if they make that choice quite knowingly, which I think they don't, they're still not ensuring their privacy unless these other steps are taken, such as companies building products and services in ways that limit the amount of data they collect, that put restrictions on how they share data, whether they obtain new consent when necessary. And finally, the question of accountability, which in my mind really has to do with whether companies will step up to owning kind of the comprehensive use of data. In the work I've been doing on voter privacy, one of the things that's been very clear to me is that you go to the Obama or the Romney website in the last presidential election, there's a standard commercial type of privacy policy, but there's no acknowledgement that in addition to data that's being collected from that website, they're buying data from data brokers, they're buying data from cable boxes, they're acquiring data from public records, they're combining all of this data, they're using it in new ways. Obviously, in an election, it's the candidate who would have to step up to that. In other contexts, it would be other major firms, but there's a tendency today instead for each player to have this very narrow, discrete view, and then to just kind of point around vaguely and say it's up to somebody else to look after their privacy. We got your consent. And unless consent is obtained against this broader background of data minimization and accountability, then I think it's a complete failure. But if it's in this larger setting, then I think it still has a role to play.
Yeah, two quick thoughts. I mean, first on consent and on the commercial side, I think it was put well. I mean, the fundamental role of notice and consent is to ensure that people are in control of their information and don't give it to others without knowing that they're doing it and without giving their approval. And it's clearly challenged by the sheer volume of all of the notices. And as Ira points out, it's far less than clear today that the consent is as meaningful as it was perhaps intended 20 or 30 years ago. Now the question is, what do we do because of that? And I think part of the answer is in some of these fair information practices, But I think that there's room for technology investment and technology innovation in a new generation of notice and consent tools. I mean, there are digital dashboards that one now sometimes sees that could probably be made better and more comprehensive in the future so that people can go and see what information exists about them and they can determine within some certainly reasonable limits how that information is continued to be used, if at all. I think as it connects to the government side, I think first, I agree with the way you put it, Mike. I mean, it's unclear to me what the right vocabulary is for what we have now. The new normal definitely captures it, but there's so many things that are part of the new normal that we probably need some kind of new label. But I think where we fundamentally see this is it was understood in the past that you didn't have a reasonable expectation of privacy under the Fourth Amendment if you took information and you put it somewhere else where I'll say it was accessible to the public. And what the Supreme Court has struggled with for a number of decades really is, well, when do you do that in a way that causes you to lose your reasonable expectation of privacy? Now, if we put a letter in the mail, we send it, but we don't lose that expectation because it's understood that legally it's only the recipient who's permitted to open it. Where things sort of went in a different direction is when people took things and they stored them somewhere else where your possessions were commingled with lots of other people's possessions. Then it was considered that you no longer had this reasonable expectation of privacy. Well, at one level with physical goods, you could understand that. But now think about your data. Okay, if it's on my hard disk, I expect it to be private, but if it's on a server computer in a data center and hence in the cloud, do I no longer have an expectation of privacy? I would argue you do. And I think that that's sort of part of what we need to hope the Supreme Court moves to in order to ensure that privacy is protected in the context of government surveillance in the future.
Yeah. So one way we can look at this issue about consent, I think, is it's part of a really sort of very long-running debate in this country and presumably elsewhere and probably in human rights circles as well between the kind of liberty that comes from making choices about agreeing to things and the kind of liberty that comes when there are regulations that sort of assist you in being able to go about living your life. And I think of a little court case called Lochner that dealt with that. So it's an issue that's been with us for a long time. And I want to see if we can move, you know, with that in the background, thinking about this tension, to talk about the implications for thinking about consent and thinking about how to regulate data flow and privacy to the development of big data and data mining techniques. Because this is clearly an important technological development. It permeates both private and public sectors. And it has raised sort of both very extravagant claims of, you know, optimistic claims about what great things it will do for society and also incredible fears of what will happen. And so I think one of the things that the big data situation does is it takes us into a place where on the one hand, there is an argument that really I don't think existed before, that we need to collect all this data because we're going to have to use all of it in order to do the analysis, coupled at the same time with a really increased unpredictability about what is going to be done with this data, what is going to be found, sort of, you know, emerge from it, hidden in it, and what it's all going to be used for. And for a long time, we had this focus on advertising. This is all about advertising. But I think more recently, concerns are starting to become sharper about other kinds of uses, both by government and by the private sector. So I guess what I want to do is just open that topic up to the panel and see what people think about how this development should affect our approach to regulation on either the private or public sector side, or maybe combined. Anybody want to go first talking about that?
Yeah, I have a couple thoughts. I mean, one is that in talking about consent a moment ago, we were really looking at whether one of the fundamental principles of this group of principles called the Fair Information Practices is working. I think big data does two things, or that it spurred a conversation about two things. One is that it's challenged these fair information practices even more fundamentally, in the sense that the very premise of big data is that you collect as much data as possible for the discovery of unanticipated insights in the future. And the fair information practices are premised on notions like stating in advance the purpose for collection, stating in advance limitations on use and disclosure. And those two, I think, are fundamentally in tension in a way that's going to be very difficult to resolve. The second thing that's beginning to happen, at least in privacy circles, is a new emphasis on concerns of discrimination. And I think this is what Kathy was alluding to in the past. There had been a lot of debates around advertising, and there had been a very kind of classic industry response that said, well, what does it matter if we're collecting all this data? All we want to do is target you with more relevant ads that you'll find more interesting and pertinent. And so what if we have all this information? And now I think the concern is that big data will be collected in ways that determine opportunities that are presented to you, credit opportunities, insurance opportunities, the cost of premiums, et cetera, and that a lot of data that's not regulated currently, for example, by the Fair Credit Reporting Act, will be used as a substitute for that regulated data to determine what opportunities are presented to you. So one idea for how to possibly address this going forward, which I find appealing, I don't think it's a complete answer, but it's a starting point, is if in fact big data also provides a great many benefits to citizens and consumers through greater efficiency, et cetera, I think an interesting prospect would be to make this data available to citizens and consumers in a way that they can get the data themselves. And then they can use independently developed tools to analyze that data for their own purposes. And I think that's important for several reasons. One is that it's much more fair to give not only the companies that acquire the data through largely unregulated and unknown means to see the benefit of this data and the analytic insights that flow from it, but to make it available to individuals as well. Second, I think it makes the whole topic much more salient to the individual. If they see the extent of data that's collected on them, I think that would be extremely eye-opening in a way that just looking at privacy notices is not. And finally, I think it would spur competition, because it wouldn't be just one single company that has the advantage of collecting all this data, but the data would then be available, and you could use the best tool for your own purposes, doing, you know, not only what the insurance companies want you to do vis-a-vis health and medical practice and insurance, et cetera, but what works for you.
I think there's a couple things to think about. I think one is, it's helpful. A lot of technology work is done around scenarios. You know, so you can think about scenarios where big data is used for medical research, for scientific research. This is one of the areas where people talk about collecting a lot, having a lot, and being able to get great benefits out of it. I think the question is whether one can expect people to engage in the development of more robust anonymization technologies and use them, and whether then society and people would feel more comfortable with all of this data continuing to be used. And I can see that as a regulatory question for the future. You know, what will be the definition of robust anonymization, and when will that be the price that one must pay, in effect, in order to retain and use all of these data? I think when you think about individual use of computing devices, there's a tremendous interest in the technology sector in using more data to provide you with more things. And you know, at one level, there's the things that I might personally argue are somewhat trivial, like Google reads all your email and Gmail so it can give you a better ad. You know, Outlook.com doesn't. I personally don't get up in the morning thinking, gosh, my day will be so much better if I could just get a better ad. Yeah, I just think that's relatively trivial. Now, on the other hand, I've got to go to the airport later. So I'll walk out and I'll have this question in my head. It'll be, how long will it take for the taxi to get to the airport. Now, you think about that, and like, I know, oh, it's Newark Airport. I know where I am. You know, and so the question is, what's the traffic right now between where I'm standing and Newark Airport? Well, we're really at the cusp of smartphones and cloud services having the ability for you to type in or speak into your phone and say, how long will it take for the taxi to get from here to the airport? First, it's important that the smartphone be able to use the fact that it knows where I am. I'm not in Los Angeles, I'm in New York. Second, if I always go to Newark Airport rather than LaGuardia or JFK, you know, it can use that and it can personalize the experience and improve it. And I think many in our industry, including I, would argue that's actually beneficial. But it sort of goes back to consent. You can craft those kinds of scenarios. So in effect, you inform people what you're going to do with their data. And yeah, there ought to be ways we can do it better and simpler than we do today. And we let people know that we're continuing to do it. And we'll do it if people want. And if people say, no, I actually want to go do a search for traffic between, you know, Washington Square and Newark Airport, that's okay too. But people can make their choice.
Okay, I'm really torn now because I want to hear the rest of the panel, but we're also running so low on time. So I think at this point we should turn to getting some questions from the audience, and we'll ask people to put their hands up and hopefully our panelists, while answering a couple questions, can squeeze in what they're dying to say right now anyway. So questions? Yes, there's one over there.
Hi, I wanted to say it's really commendable what Microsoft has been doing in terms of fighting for its customers' rights, and a lot of companies don't do that, and I'm wondering what we can do, both as consumers and as citizens, to help push companies towards fighting for their customers' rights.
Well, I think it's actually quite simple. Companies do things that they believe are going to, you know, help them grow their business, and the fundamental question about these issues is, do people care? And if people care, you know, I think it's actually very healthy if they vote with their voice and, you know, provide feedback. Thank you. And I think it's also really important that people vote with their wallet and their pocketbook. So, you know, I think as if more consumers actually choose services from companies that are focused on privacy, that'll reshape the marketplace probably faster than anything else.
And I know Mike wanted to say something about that, and we have a hand over there.
So. Yeah. I would just add, one of the things that I think consumers can do and investors is to push companies in this industry to work together and to set common standards and ways of operating. Microsoft, with Google and Yahoo, were the first into something called the Global Network Initiative. Ira and I worked on that together. It was really an effort to look at internet freedom and privacy, to set a common standard for the industry, and then to begin to look at the things that Brad talked about, oversight, transparency, and accountability. Facebook has recently sort of joined it, but in a slightly different way, a few other companies, but a lot of the telephone companies aren't part of it. There really needs to be a common discussion about all of these issues so that as consumers you can say, we can evaluate companies one against another, companies help each other. When we talk about transparency, for example, everybody's operating with the same standard. They can help each other grow, and we as consumers can help push them to do the right thing.
I saw a hand back there.
I have a question for Mr. Smith. One of your remarks was that we would need some sort of international law or regulation to really help guide the infrastructure of the internet, especially with regards to privacy. Knowing how hard it is to actually get an international agreement of any sort done on the global forum, what would be the most effective way to get that sort of agreement out, and who would be involved, like what organizations, if you could maybe name a certain example?
Well, I think in brief, one probably has to start with on a bilateral basis or with a small number of governments, and one could imagine, for example, an agreement where, you know, a company in one country would be able to serve the consumers in another, but pursuant to a common legal framework that actually governed, among other things, surveillance standards. In other words, law enforcement or intelligence agencies would have access
to information about the citizens in another country, but only pursuant to the legal processes and guarantees. And if you did that, between, I'll just say Germany and the United States, for example, you could create a model. I think you have to create a model, and then you can grow the number of people who are part of it, and you have to be very thoughtful to ensure that the people who sign on are actually committed to it.
Okay, we can have one more question. And I know some people are already having to run off to class.
Well, I just have a question about notice and consent, and I had another comment, but I'll hold that. The tech industry is very good about standard setting. I mean, they get together in, like, WC3. What would you think about, like, a standardized setting approach similar to, like, the GPL for privacy policies, where industry gets together with other stakeholders and comes up with some sort of standardized form similar to the GPL?
I would not be a fan of that, because it would say that people would no longer compete with each other. We would all do the same thing. And the standards are important. I mean, Mike was suggesting it before. There are definitely areas where standardization is important, and it's definitely true for base technologies. I'll sign on to it in the context of the international human rights challenges. But, for example, what if we had a standard agreement on the prices we would all charge? That's called price fixing. Look, in the world today, when consumer services are free, there is still a price for a free service. It's the amount of personal information that is collected. And it's then what the companies do with that personal information. And in my opinion, if there were a completely standardized agreement between all of the principal companies in the tech sector about what they would do on privacy, it would, in a practical way, be tantamount to an agreement on, in effect, the price that would be charged. And I think people will benefit more if there's competition. And that will hopefully be spurred on by innovation. One of the challenges is whenever you standardize something, you actually run a risk that there will be less innovation, because people no longer feel the need to develop something in competition with each other.
Okay, well, obviously this conversation could go on for quite a lot longer, but unfortunately we are out of time. So thank you very much to Brad and to the panel.